So basically, what we're going to do is we're just going to take about 40 minutes or so and just chat and just pick these guys' brains, really, on this topic of the Holy Spirit and see how we go. Yeah, happy? You guys all excited about this? But what I thought we'll do, first of all, I don't know how you found Steve Apple's session we've just listened to. Rise. Yikes, man. I'm actually glad. I'm glad he wasn't in the room, personally. Just stay over there in London somewhere and just, you know, it's hard enough. Yeah, exactly. Isn't it true? It's like, just stay over. Oh, you muted it. I think you just muted it.
Oh, did I? I haven't done that.
Yeah, just push it. There we go.
There we go. Yeah, I was going to say, the funny thing about Steve is if you go for lunch with Steve, he's exactly the same as he is when he's speaking on a screen or a conference. So, you know, wherever he is, he's the same everywhere. Same intensity, same challenge.
Yeah, I know.
You know, so it was good.
Basically,
it was really good.
Once a year is enough by the sounds of it. So, brilliant. Hey, so listen, genuinely, what reflections did you guys have, you know, just on that session? And also, if there's time, we will get like a Q&A from you guys on the floor if you want to ask any questions and stuff as well. So so we can ask questions regarding Duncan's session earlier as well, and just on some of the words went on there. And then, but on Steve Apple, like just any, what struck you? Did anything like particularly come out from that, if you can digest it?
Can you hear me? Yeah. I mean, I'm just blown away by what he said and the potential of our part to play in God doing something really incredible across this nation. And for me, the thing that stuck out was that I felt for a long time, actually, just the call that God is calling a beautiful bride that you are significantly part of. And he's saying, I want a pure bride. And I just think the challenge for us to lay everything down, to surrender all, to yield to Jesus completely and know him and let him into the places that have been painful and that has held you back, that might have caused you might have been disappointed or this mystery that you don't know how to move through in. And I just think it's saying, God, I'm going to let you in. Do you know he knows anyway, all those secret things maybe that you might do, that God is saying, I want a pure bride. And everything, do you know, and I think just the beauty of consecration, actually, of just saying, Jesus, this is about you. And it was lovely, Justin and I were praying for each other, just when we were just praying, and just the beauty of just priorities. Actually, what are we prioritizing our life with, and what are we looking for, and what are we giving our time to? Because that's where our heart is, right? So it's just a call to be all in, for purity, for consecration.
It's great. Yeah, just jump in. Don't like, you know, don't do a Zoom call where everybody just goes quiet.
That's right. I mean, I literally felt like I was in a boxing ring being struck from every side as... So I feel a bit bruised in a good way. I think prophetic voices are such a gift to us, and I think Steve genuinely is a prophetic voice to the church in this season. And so I think that's one of the reasons why God is opening doors for Steve to give that message, because I do feel like he's a bit of a mouthpiece from the Lord to us, actually, in this season. At a personal level, I feel very provoked about... do I still have the same passion for revival that I used to have? And am I still willing to pay the price? So I think one of the things that struck me was where he said, revelation that's not nurtured will be lost.
Yeah.
So so that personally, that's a challenge to me. So it made me think, okay, what revelation am I carrying from the Lord that I'm not nurturing at the moment? I don't want to lose any of the revival seed that's been sown in me. And so I think that's a personal provocation. I think I was very struck by also what he said about God breaking down denominationalism in this season, which I think is absolutely bang on. So I think the fact this new move of God is going to look very different to the previous one, I think is absolutely bang on. And I think it's a challenge for us, because probably many of us in this room will have been raised or nurtured in a kind of restoration churches that have probably been going for 40 plus years. And generally movements die after the third generation. And we are right on the cusp of that. And we therefore have some radical decisions to make about, are we going to pursue the Holy Spirit in this next season of our life rather than just try and protect what God's done in the previous generation? And so I think that there's a book by Steve Addison called The Rise and Fall of Movements. And he charts Christian movements over hundreds of years and traces how rarely movements get beyond the third generation. And he says, usually it's because you have this growth arc from its radical beginnings where you're just sold out for the Holy Spirit. You'll do anything he tells you. You'll break tradition. You'll run into headlong kind of courage, you know, kind of steps of obedience, breaking the norms. But then he said, you hit a point in the movement where you start trying to protect what you've gained. And he calls that the failure of success. So it's where you try and protect what you've gained rather than keep with your radical movement of wanting to pursue the Holy Spirit. And he says, when you get into protectionism, your movement starts to die. Because what gave birth to it in the first place has been lost. And I think it was Arthur Wallace who said, a move of God will only last as long as the spirit of prayer that first inspired it. And so I think for me, that call back to radical prayer, which is the fuel of revival, is the thing that I'm going to take away from that.
So can I ask you just a follow-up question on that? It might be a little bit sensitive, but if you are in a movement right now, then what would your response be? Because if it's a bit like movements are shifting, all that kind of stuff, like what would your response be in regards to that? Like I said, sensitive question. But
no, it's a great question. I mean, I think first you... Reformation has to start on the inside of you first. So I think before you lob stones into someone else's culture, check the culture of your own heart first. So are you a man or woman of prayer?
Yeah.
Are you someone who's radically committed to the promises of God? Are you living a missional lifestyle? Are you radically obeying the Holy Spirit? Are you the Holy Spirit's friend? That's the thing. I would start at home first. How's the culture of my heart? Am I living and walking out of repentance and consecration, like Joe said? So I think it starts there, but then I think God always reforms the church by sending the prophets. And so I think, listen to the prophets. We tend to honor the prophets after they're dead, when we realize that what they said was right. Or we only listen to the prophets when it confirms what we're already doing. But God sends us prophets to shake us out of lethargy and complacency and to call us back to the purposes of God.
Yeah.
And so I think we need to be prophetic mouthpieces where we see drift in the church. And obviously we do that with kingdom values, with love, with honor, with respect, all that kind of good, gooey stuff of the kingdom. But nevertheless, as Steve said, we need to stand up to our full height and we need to declare things from God's perspective. So I think there's something about recovering God's prophetic call in this season.
I mean, one of the things I'm noticing in environments that we're in or I'm in is that although there's still denominations, actually I think the matrixing across denominations is fascinating to watch. And I think the connection points are because I think there's a shared desire for the nation. So we're in a context where there's one particular vicar in Church of England in London. Right. St. Paul's Hammersmith, where they are on fire for the presence of God. Radical, radical, radical. Mm. That's the Church of England. So what you can't do is have these labels, and you find, I think increasingly, and I think Steve's strong on this, if leaders will humble themselves and not look to the denominational lines, and I think they connect at a different level. And I think one of the things that certainly happened for me when we were in... Bogota in Colombia with the church there, I think the UK, because you're in a context where people are waving flags for every nation apart from, let alone hardly any in Europe, it's all Latin America, and you're saying, I've got our Union Jack. And I think something was birthed in terms of what it is for this nation. So I know that we want to reach the nations, but I think particularly us guys in the UK are often quite embarrassed about our own nation, even some of our history, and thinking, how do we together reach how does the fire of revival come to the UK? And so one of the things I've been increasingly stirred about is Jean Darnell's word from 1967. And when you read about that, the fires come from the north and the south. And and I think some of it is his leaders saying, we will connect for a bigger purpose than denominational lines. But actually being in a denomination is fine. It's more around how do we... we're beginning to connect across all sorts of environments and into all sorts... And I think... For us, that culture of honour, saying what have you got? How do we learn? Mm. How do we serve? How do we come in low? All of that stuff, I think, isn't where we were probably. No. And I think that's some of the reality, isn't it? How do we do that?
Great. And did you have any reflections, Duncan, from Steve?
I think a bit like Phil. That guy is intense.
He needs a chill pill, that guy. Yeah. I tell you.
I mean, I think one of my reflections is. It's back to some of the spiritual disciplines. I mean, again, here is a local church. We're saying, how do we pray? How do we fast? How do we this stuff that we know? And we think, oh yeah, that's the serious stuff. I think I've got out of the habit of fasting, got out of the habit of seeking the Lord in that way, and thinking, how do I do that? I certainly think personally that was already. How do I get with the Lord in a different way and learn to walk with Him?
Yeah.
But I think the Steve piece is. So phrases like, we're trying to live more simply, throwaway phrases, okay, that's powerful, isn't it? What stuff, box sets, you know, all of this stuff. What's our conversation? What's our affection towards? You're like, oh, that's, I need to process that. I think, okay, what does that mean?
That's good. And it's interesting, isn't it? When he says things like, even like, fast twice a week. I mean, fasting once a month is like, you know.
Once a year, maybe.
Yeah, exactly. But it's interesting, isn't it? It's like the amount of kind of comfortableness that we are as Christians, we almost don't even realize just how comfortable we are because we're just cruising around and then, oh, fast twice a week. You're like, what on earth are you talking about? Kind of stuff, isn't it? And it's, I think that's almost like a blink. We might be blinkered as Christians about just how comfortable life is. Watching our box sets, doing our stuff, coming to church, nice music, go back home, all those kind of things. I think he's disrupting that.
Yes.
Which I think is really good.
Yeah, 100%. I think maybe every culture is like this, but certainly I can speak from a British culture. We're so in our own bubble with all of its strengths and weaknesses. And I was chatting recently to a friend of mine who's a church planter in Kenya. And he's planting a new church into a very kind of rural, very, very poor part of Kenya. He lives by subsistence farming. He probably has one meal a day. Recent kind of mixture of famine and kind of drought and then floods have washed his crops away. And I'm like, what are you doing? And his daily answer is, I'm just trusting Jesus. Jesus always provides. And so he's going to this new village to plant a church. And so the way they do it is they went into the village and they prayed for 24 hours in the village together. And in the morning, a family brought to them their son, who was mute from birth and had never, ever spoken. And they said, can you lay hands on our son and pray for him? And so they pray for this little boy, who his first word he says is, hallelujah.
Wow.
And... So my friend Africano sends me a video of this little boy sitting on his knee and speaking his first words. I mean, it's just like phenomenal.
Wow.
And their church has grown from 4 to 60 people within, you know, the matter of a few months. But for me, I'm just thinking, when was the last time I prayed for 24 hours for the breaking into the kingdom? You know, and I think it's just that different mindset. And it comes from his daily life of, I just trust the Lord. He provides for me. And so I think there's something about God breaking us out of our bubbles, our consumerism, our entitlement, our lethargy, our apathy. I think you have to contextualize the gospel for where you are. So it's going to look different. You know, how you reach your neighbors in Britain looks going to be different to how you reach them in rural Kenya. But we still got to have the same mindset of I'm trusting the Father and prayer is what makes the difference. So I think there's something of that that God is wanting to shift and recalibrate.
That's good.
Yeah, I think it's also really key for everybody to know that you are significant and you're a part of this. And actually, you're a part of this beauty that is called the corporate church, the people together. And you, it's so easy to look and say, oh, it's easy for those people to do that, or it's easy for them to do that, or they're in a better position to do that. But I just wanted to just to say, you guys are called for such a time as this, that you have a significant part to play. And actually, your prayers make a difference when you pray. You are significant in your prayer life. You know, where you put your time and you put your affections, it is significant. You are significant for what God is doing at the, in this place at this time. You have a significant part to play. Just really felt it's important to say that.
Great, thank you. All right, I'm going to move it on to the Holy Spirit for a minute. So, how would you rate your relationship with the Holy Spirit? Out of 10.
Not very well after Steve's session.
Well, when we came back from Colombia, it was like, I mean, to be honest, we went to this conference and it was just breathtakingly wild, crazy, like, what on earth have I come to? And I came away thinking, do I actually know the Holy Spirit? Like, this is unbelievable. It's just showing us a new way of relationship and intimacy and friendship with the Holy Spirit that I'd never known before. And we went to Wildfires a year ago, and I I was like, I want to know the Holy Spirit more. And I remember we heard, was it Tyler Staton? And he showed, he said, this is how I start my day. And I've been doing it since then, and it's amazing. So you start your day, like, you get your Bible. I sit in bed. Duncan brings me a nice cup of tea. Thanks very much. Keep doing that. I love it. And just open your hands and say, come, Holy Spirit. What do you want to say to me today? What do you have today? And there'll be a scripture or a memory or a verse or a word pop into my head that says, okay, I'm going to journal. I'm going to write down about this. And then I'm going to pray. Open the Bible. What does the Bible say alongside this? What do you have for me today that you want me to take out of what you've just told me? Like, how is this going to impact my day? And it does. It's incredible. And I just think it's being open, isn't it, to the Holy Spirit at work in your life and being expectant to hear from him.
Okay, thank you. It's great. Gentlemen?
Yeah, I mean, if I'm really honest, I thought I knew the Holy Spirit, and then I realized I've only just started. That's honestly what happened. That's in great. Columbia. Yeah. So I think when you begin this journey, you think, okay, so even what I'm preaching today is I'm on a journey. So I think so much in the West is we know the concepts and we can order it, but how are we living it? So I think I'm on the journey and I'm learning. So I don't know if I can rate it out of 10. I don't know. Yeah. But it wasn't. It's not as high as I thought it was.
I'd be exactly the same boat. I think. I mean, I've been in Christian, like, full-time Christian leadership for probably a similar time to Duncan, 25, nearly 30 years. And I think I find the constant challenge is not just to operate out of principle, but how to operate out of presence. And I think it's very easy, and I've been guilty of this many times, where you settle for charismatic principles without intimacy with the Holy Spirit. And the reality is, the gifts of the Spirit, they're gifts, they're not awards for good behavior. Which means you can operate in the gifts of the Spirit with no intimacy with Jesus.
Wow. I was going to ask you this, right? As a prophet, right? You go around churches, you might be in this room, you might be prophesying just like that to all sorts of people right now. And the assumption is, man, you're hearing the Spirit all over the place and you're sensitive to the Holy Spirit, which means, or the assumption is, you're walking closely with the Holy Spirit. Do you see what I mean?
Right.
And you're saying, not necessarily.
Not necessarily.
Yikes.
No.
We're in trouble.
Thanks, prophet.
Yeah. I mean, but that is an incredibly scary thing, that you can operate in God's gifts, but not actually be walking in integrity with the Lord or intimacy with the Lord. Now, I think when you use the gifts without intimacy, then you don't bear fruit, and there's not anointing. I think anointing comes when you're walking with intimacy and you're walking in your identity. Wow. That's actually what brings anointing.
Say that again.
When you're walking in your identity and intimacy, that's what brings anointing. And I think that's, again, where the difference between excellence and anointing. So excellence is doing the best with what you have, but anointing is God doing what you can't.
Wow.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
And so I think sometimes we settle for excellence when actually God's offering anointing, and that only comes through intimacy. So I think we've got to learn in this season how to, and the difference, of course, is walking in friendship with the Spirit. So how do you grow in intimacy with the Lord? How do you grow in a lifestyle of anointing as you walk with the Lord? You get to know Him, you obey Him. And I think friendship is unfolding like any relationship. So I think it's, again, I would just encourage you, like Joe's encouraged us, is we don't mark our scorecard and say, gosh, I don't know the Lord very well. I'm not a very good Christian. No. You've been called into a relational lifestyle with God, and it's a journey. So like my relationship with my wife is a journey. And I'm getting to know her day by day, week after week, month by month, year after year. And it's not that I'm marking my scorecard. It's that we're doing life together. It's relational. And so you're in a relationship with Jesus where you're walking with Him, learning to talk with Him, learning to obey Him, sometimes messing up, sometimes failing, sometimes not hitting the mark, knowing you need to grow. But that's life, isn't it? That is relationship. And so, I think, how would I rate my relationship with the Lord? I want to know the Lord more.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's like the Apostle Paul at the end of his life, when he's writing Philippians, you know, I want to know the Lord.
Yeah.
I consider everything else a loss for the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I've lost all things. I consider everything a loss. So, you know, right at the end of his life, he's like, I still want to know the Lord.
Yeah.
And I think we'll be like that till our dying day. We should be like that till our dying day.
Yeah, that's great. It's good. Sorry, I'm just reflecting. Good, okay. Yeah, I think I'm all right. So how would you cultivate, how would you say you would cultivate like relationship with the Lord, hearing the Holy Spirit and so on? What kind of, is it like disciplines you guys do? What kind of, what do you do? Or is it like, how would you say you do that? Any ideas, thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, I think it is that time in learning how you hear Him, and I think my experience is stepping out. So I think and having a go. So I think that so many of these things are interrelated. So I think the identity piece, knowing who you are in Christ, becomes super important, because if it does come down to, but what if it doesn't work, and there's a piece of you that gets eroded in that when it doesn't, then I think you're less likely to take risks. So knowing God's a good Father. He loves his children, having a go, risk over success, those sort of things. And I think then it's a journey and it's an adventure and a friendship rather than a set of, did I get it right and am I in the good books? And I think that those are, depending on where you're doing that, I think the application would be different. For me, it's sometimes from a platform, sometimes though it will be with people, you know, directly. So it's like, how do we do that? And a culture that is able to encourage one another into that. So I found those pieces quite key. You know, have a go and be that whole thing. I was trying to say that don't quench the Spirit. Like, be quick to obey. If you think He's spoken, then go for it. But what if He hasn't? And what's the worst that can happen, right?
Yeah.
So I remember someone saying, sometimes I step out to bring a prophecy before the Lord's even given it. It's like, right. So it's like, because your trust in the Lord will fill your mouth, and you get, so it's kind of thing, actually, have I got the mind of Christ? Is this something of the Lord? Can I bring this? Is there something prophetic in it? And so overthinking, I think, sometimes hasn't always helped us. And how do I know it's just not natural encouragement? Is it prophetic? All of this stuff, I think, can get in the way. And I think we just learn as we go, like we are as children. So.
And your inheritance is to hear the voice of the Father, right?
Exactly.
So that's a lie that we all need to make sure we kind of dismiss, that it's your inheritance to hear the voice of God, right, as a son or daughter. So got to get that solid in your foundations, otherwise you will struggle. Anything else from you guys?
I think I am just really challenged about I'm starting a new venture of what I put my time to, and just being open to be led by the Holy Spirit rather than make it happen. Because it's so easy just to think, oh, I know how to do it. I know how to put my structures in place. But it's being open, isn't it? And I think it's just being available to saying, I just want you to speak into this. I want your voice. I want the path to open up where you want to take me, which might be completely different to where you've been. So I think it's just having an openness to, like, change and just the pressure coming off and just saying, I'm going to rely on knowing you.
Great. One of the things I'd like to encourage you is that I think an obedient heart is a doorway often to hear the Lord. Do you know what I mean? It's like actually, because I always think about this, is that in our desire to hear what God says, in any way, there should be at the same time the eagerness to obey what he says. Because you know what he's going to say to you, right? So, I'm so desperate to hear the voice of God. Yeah, well, go to another country. Yeah, no, never mind. I don't want to do that, right? Yeah, pass on that. And I think that's the thing. It's almost like, so one of the questions I'm always wondering, you could test this, is that if you feel like, I don't hear the Holy Spirit a lot, ask yourself whether your heart is always open to want to obey whatever he says. And maybe over time, it's almost that's corroded. But as you have an obedient heart, maybe you'll hear the voice of the Lord much more in what you're doing. Phil, I'm going to ask you a question. There's a thing here, talk about, I'm going to read it. Talk to us about your call to raise up intercessors and prophets. That sounds serious. What does that mean and so what does that look like and so on?
Good question, Morning.
Yeah, I know. Who wrote that?
It's almost like I wrote that question for myself. I should have thought of an answer as well. I think for Carol and I, and by the way, Carol she's so gutted to not be here, and she just sends her love, and she's got this horrible kind of flu thing, and she sounded like Barry White first thing this morning. As I left her, she's like, bye, Phil, have a good time. I was like, don't recognise who you are, but so she's so sad to not be here. But I think in the recent past, we've felt God really speaking to us about doing more together. And I think one of the things that I know I'm called to is to help raise up prophets. And one of the things that she feels called to do is help raise up intercessors. And so I think in this season of our life, a little bit like Joe, we're kind of in this kind of adventure. What do we do with this, Lord? And we've been doing much of that in our kind of work lives through church and through Catalyst and sort of translocal ministry. And I think our desire is to raise up healthy, dynamic, spirit-filled prophets and intercessors. My personal take is that there's a lot of brilliant things going on in the body of Christ, but there's also some gaps where I would love to see healthy prophets who love the Word of God, who love the local church, who love a kingdom lifestyle, who are not completely eccentric and divorced from the local church, who are serving in their local communities, who are people you can actually get to know. They're in the body, for the body, but are moving in the power of the Spirit and are bringing contribution that's vital right in this season. So I think our heart is to kind of coach, to train, to help identify, getting alongside people who have that call, whether it's in an embryonic form. I can't remember right who it was that said, but basically, you know, God often gives us revelation in seed form because he's looking to see what we'll do with it. So inside every apple pit, there's an apple tree if you'll nurture it.
Right, wow, yeah.
So again, what Steve was saying, if you don't nurture revelation, it can get lost. And so I think very often God's planting seeds in our heart of callings. So for example, the calling to be a prophet, might be some people here, you've got a calling to be a prophet. It's like an apple pip. What are you going to do with that? And how are you going to grow that into something? And so I think our heart is to come alongside people who've got that calling and to help nurture and bring That's it to great. Life. So I hope that
and
answers
how,
your
and
question.
How, so how does that work? Is there like a website? Is there like, help me, Phil? Like,
help me.
Yeah.
Help like, me, help you, help
yeah,
me.
Yeah, yeah. How do you guys do it? Like, how do people get involved or get contact, that kind of thing?
Yeah, I mean, we're just set up a new little embryonic kind of coaching business called Prophetic Connections. So there's a simple website online called propheticconnections.org. Right. And we're starting to kind of run kind of coaching, kind of training sessions online for kind of budding prophets and intercessors. And yeah, if you feel called to that, then get in touch. And we'd just love to kind of come alongside you and work with you. Also wanting to help church leaders and those in kind of different spheres of influence think through how can we build prophetic cultures? Yes. What does it look like to build a prophetic culture? And again, I think one of the keys I learned, I think, again, probably the first time I went to Bethel was I learned the difference between churches that have some prophecies and churches that have a prophetic culture.
Yeah.
And there's a big difference. So I'd say to you, don't settle to be just the church that has a few prophecies.
Mm.
There's something much deeper and more dynamic. And I remember the first time I went to Bethel, by the time I'd sat in my chair for the first meeting, four people had prophesied over me.
Wow.
One in the bookshop, one in the coffee queue, one on our way in, and one was the lady sitting in front of us. And I'll never forget it because we went in, and before we went, we prayed, God, would you give someone a desire to invite us back to their house for lunch? We prayed that before we went. And we're like, God, and we'd like them to have children the same age as our children. Okay, so that's what we prayed. And so we sat at our seats, didn't know anybody in this church with about 1,000 people in the room. And after worship finished, this lady turned round and she'd written directions to her house on the back of a napkin. And she said, I don't know if this will mean anything to you, but during the worship, I felt God say I should invite you back to our house for lunch.
Wow.
We've got two children. They look the same age as your children. And in case you want to say yes, I've drawn a map to our house.
That's so cool, isn't it?
And so I was like, what is this? This is amazing. And I think we were experiencing what a prophetic culture feels like. We can all hear God. And so, again, I think if you're interested in how do we develop cultures of the prophetic where we all get to participate, then again, we just love to have a conversation.
Yeah, that's
so
lovely.
Get in touch. Man. So it's propheticconnections.org.
Wow, what an amazing, encouraging church to be in. Hey, prophetic
right,
everywhere.
Yeah, absolutely. Jeez. Yeah.
Wow, and outside. Okay, well, I'm going to open up the opportunity for a bit of questions. Does anybody actually have any questions that's burning? But I actually have a question that doesn't have to be like intense or anything, but hands up quickly if there is anybody. Otherwise, we might finish early. Or you're all just too very polite. Is that what's going on? Yeah, or shy. There you go. Go on then.
Everyone's sitting wanting to go home early, and there's one guy that wants a question. We talk about prophetic culture, so how do you create that in a community? I know it's a big question. A few little tips about if you're thinking, well, we'd love to do that. Or maybe you're in a community where you've kind of done that before, but maybe it hasn't, you know, and it's kind of lost the momentum and needs to go again. How do you do that?
Great. Well, I've got a 45-minute seminar for you. Strap on your seatbelts. No. I mean, just a few thoughts. I think there's a number of things. Obviously, it depends on where you're starting from. I think often churches are led by pastor teachers. And so I think in my experience, one of the first things you've got to do is biblically understand where you root this in Scripture. So where's the vision for a prophetic community in the Bible? So we've got to root it in the Word of God and establish that this is something that God wants and is normative for the church. I think second thing is you dial into identity and kingdom values, so understanding who we are, because otherwise the prophetic becomes a crown on your head rather than a tool that you use. And so actually what we believe is my identity is that I'm a son first, and the prophetic is a tool that God gives me. And if those get flipped round, then we can easily build a culture that's dysfunctional.
So if
I believe that my gifts define who I am, that's a recipe for a dysfunctional culture. So I think you've got to root a prophetic culture in identity and who the Father is and who I am as his child. So I think Scripture, identity. And then I think there's all sorts of things that we can do that help create culture in terms of the prophetic. Obviously, we establish... Everyone can hear God. Sons and daughters get to hear the Father. Just what Mornay says. This is not an exclusive club. We all get to hear him. He's our Father. It's in our birthright to hear him. I think other key is that you start to create a culture of obedience comes from saying yes, not from outcomes. Mm. So you start to create an environment where you understand, okay, if I'm going to grow, we need a research and development culture in the church.
Yeah.
Now, I think most of the church is so riddled with fear when it comes to getting things wrong in the prophetic is that we never create opportunity to grow. But the only way to grow is to have a go and sometimes make mistakes. And the only way you will create a culture that is allowed to do that is if you get the first thing right. I'm secure in my sonship, in who I am as a son, as a daughter. And so those things go hand in hand. And so creating environments where there's opportunity to take risk,
yeah.
opportunity to grow,
yeah.
I think it's absolutely crucial. And then I would say you always need twin tracks in church life. So you need, on the one hand, we can all prophesy. So prophecy is a gift that we can all participate in. But there's a second track where some are called to be prophets. Now, prophets are not activities, they're people. They're people gifts. And so if you want to create prophetic culture, we've got to learn how to identify those that are called to be prophets. And their job is to equip God's people for works of service. Mm. And so for me, it's like finding the telephone engineers in the church. So if you invite a telephone engineer to your house, their job is not to do all the talking on your telephone. Their job is to plumb in the system so that you can talk on your own telephone. And the job of the prophets is so that you can talk to God for yourself and to hear him. And so we've got to identify those that are called to be prophets and teach them how to equip the church for works of service. So there would be a whistle-stop tour of a few kind of thoughts in terms of creating prophetic culture.
Just out of interest, do you happen to have any like books that might be helpful? Apparently you went to business...
Well, I was hoping, Justin, lunchtime. You might give a free book away at some point
actually,
later.
Actually, we are later, and just to say, the books are available in the Keith Jones bookshop, but you might want to say a little bit about what you...
Yeah, I mean, I've written a book called Developing Prophetic Culture. Thanks for that setup. I'll pay you later. Yeah. So, and that's just 10 kind of short chapters, kind of keys to how do you develop this in church life. I'd encourage you to read anything by Chris Vallotton. I think he is, I mean, I've learned so much about this journey of developing prophetic culture in church life. I'm recently rereading a book called by T. Austin Sparks called The Prophetic Ministry. Brilliant book. If you want something heavyweight about prophets, then read a book by Abraham Heschel called The Prophets. He was a Jewish scholar, wasn't actually a Christian, but he looks at who were the prophets in the Old Testament, what was the message they carried. I mean, it will blow your socks off. I understand only about half of it, but it's a brilliant kind of treatise of who were the prophets and what was their ministry and how did it affect culture. So there you go. There's a few recommendations.
Brilliant. Awesome. Is there any... Oh, right, here's a question.
Okay, I've just come back from Bethel. I had a year at Bethel, and they're just building a new building. And I hear of other churches building buildings and so on. But also, there's a bit of a whisper going around the church, which is that because it's getting darker, there's going to be persecution, and we're actually going to be reverting more and more to house churches and houses, meeting in houses. And I wondered as... From your point of view, prophetically, how do you feel about that? Or is it both and?
That's a great question. Yeah, I mean, my personal conviction is, like Steve, I think the greatest days of the church are still to come. But I don't think those great days are going to be lived in the context of comfort. I think they're actually going to be lived out in the context of greater conflict, particularly in the West. That would be my personal conviction. So I think we're coming into a cultural season of shaking, where we're going to have to learn to live out our Christian faith in an environment that's not Christendom as we've known it in the past. And when it comes to buildings, we recently as a church had some advice from an amazing prophet in the Vineyard Church who basically said to us, I'm just encouraging all churches everywhere to buy buildings at the moment. And his personal conviction is because this is going to become increasingly hard, particularly for churches that are relying on hiring school halls and public facilities to have their public services. If you may be discovering this already, if you're in a church that rents public facilities, that it's becoming increasingly hard to do so if you're openly Christian, particularly on issues around equality and sexuality and LGBT kind of issues. And there is a kind of death by association issue coming for people that feel like they don't want to hire facilities to openly Christian organizations. And so I think that is the reality that is already happening in our nation. And I think that is going to increasingly be the situation. However, I think the greatest days of the church are still to come. And I do believe that God is going to break down some of I would say, traditional models of what church looks like in the nation. And so I do think there's going to be a revival of house churches. There's a brilliant book called Microchurch, which essentially looks at what is the church. And they break the church down into three essential components, that the church is a community of worshippers on mission together. That's the church. A community of worshippers on mission together. And the reality is that you can express the church, whether that's a house church, whether it's a church that owns a facility, whether it's a church that meets in a school hall. Actually, I think there's going to come multiple ways of expressing the church in our nation. Some of those will be forced by circumstance. Some of those are going to be because people break out of some traditional forms of church in order to start new things. I would say, particularly amongst Gen Z, there is a massive drive and hunger for authenticity in the church. And I think that what that's going to cause is for lots of people under the age of 25 to start radically planting new churches. And I think often those are going to be house churches that get established in perhaps harder to reach parts of the country, harder to reach estates. And so I think, watch this space. I think there are glorious days ahead for us. But I think God is going to strip away the kind of nominalism and entitlement that has riddled the church in this nation for so long. And I think one of the anvils he's going to use for that is conflict and difficulty. That'll be my personal conviction. Mm. Feel free to disagree with me. I really don't mind.
Just coming from a perspective, obviously, in this building that we're trying to refurbish as a church, I agree with everything Phil said. And the only thing I'd add is that I think facilities like this will become resources to a community. Yeah. And so the idea that it's the sanctuary, or it's the for the church. I think the church are fronting resources to get something built that serves the vulnerable, the needy, the homeless, the guys who need to come, as it were, under the umbrella of where there's provision. And so that would be our heart. So I think that will happen whatever. And I think that will be one of the things that enables the church to shine as it's generous to its community. So I think that's pretty exciting as well. We think there's facilities that can be used as an enabler for the kingdom to come, and we can serve our community. And so that is, I think, quite exciting, and perhaps a shift from let's get a building so we can meet in it, I think, is something broader that the Lord's calling the church to do.
Brilliant. Well, I think we're going to call it there. Just give these guys a hand. Thanks so much for your wisdom.